Well, good morning. I love the verse in the Bible that says, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." And indeed, on this beautiful and special day, we come into the Lord's house recognizing how faithful, how great, how good our God is. And we come to worship Him for all He's done in our lives. And I am super glad that you are here today. Today is a special day in so many ways, and we'll be recognizing certain groups of people here today, and we'll do that in just a few minutes. But right now, I want to welcome you as a visitor. If you're here today and this is your first time being here, whether you're here with your family or just new in our community, we are just super glad that you're here today, and we hope that you have a wonderful experience with us today. So if you would do us a favor and reach in front of you, and there's a visitor's card somewhere there in the pew in front of you, if you just grab that, grab a pencil, and maybe jot down that information and put it in the offering plate so that we can just have a record to know that you were with us today and maybe reach out to you later on. We would appreciate that so much. But thank you for being here today. I cannot believe that it's May and the school is almost over for another year. And when I said that, the teachers and the students inside just hollered out a big yelp. Next week, we will be honoring a special group of people again, our seniors that are graduating from high school that have worked hard, and we look forward to honoring them and recognizing them next week. And I hope that this week, it's a big week for their families. And so, God, I pray that you just that you would ask God to be with them this week and to help them and all that they got going on. But thank you again for being here. And as we continue our worship, would you stand and just find someone around you and just tell them how glad you are to see them this morning.
Such a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Let's worship together as we sing "Shine, Jesus, Shine."
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Story.
be seated.
Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible, it tells me so. Little ones to Him belong. They are weak, oh, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me.
Thank you, Matt. How awesome was that? Thank you. Matthew 19:13 says that the people brought little children to Jesus for Him to place His hands on them and to pray for them. Today we have some parents who want to give thanks for their children. And we had the opportunity to dedicate them to the Lord, praying that they will grow up coming to know and serving Him. We also want to dedicate and pray for these parents, asking God to give them wisdom and understanding and knowledge and the ability to raise their children in the way of the Lord. And as a church, let's dedicate ourselves to setting a good example for these parents and these children as they grow their children up to be up and to grow up in the Lord. So parents, if you would now stand, and if you would just repeat, "We do," after me. As parents, do you recognize that your child is a gift from God and both thank God and glorify God for the gift of your child? Do you accept the joys and the responsibilities of parenting, promising to give proper love and care to your child throughout their lives? And with God's help, do you commit to teach your child the fullness of God's word and demonstrate through your own personal example and witness what it means to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength? Now, congregation, if you would answer, "We will," after me. Will you offer your ongoing love, support, prayers, and encouragement to these parents as they raise their children? Will you also pray for these children as much as you are able and help teach and set a godly example for them so that they may grow and one day come to trust in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior?
We will.
At this time, I would like to introduce you and present you a certificate of dedication. Avelina Madeline Broom, parents Stephanie and Nicholas. Ruth Nell Edwards, parents Catherine and Matthew. Thank y'all for being here. Evelyn June Jenkins, parents Mackenzie and Noah. John Shepherd Jones, parents Brittany and Weston. John Whitaker Shue, parents Jenna and Josh. Make sure I'm smiling good up here. I see a lot of cameras. At this time, if you are a proud grandparent, if you would stand up. Maybe you're a great grandparent in here. Any proud brothers or sisters? Y'all please stand up. Aunts, uncles, cousins. Anybody that wants to stand up, please stand up. We're so thankful for you and that you could be here today, and I would love to pray for your family now. Father, we are so thankful for this time, and we do give thanks for these children. And we thank you for this opportunity today that we have to dedicate them to you, and we do pray that they will grow up, that they would grow to know you, and that they would serve you. God, Father, I'm thankful for these parents. We pray dedication on them. It's tough days to be a parent. And God, we ask you that you would give them wisdom and your understanding and knowledge and their ability to raise their children in the way that you would have them to. And as a church, God, I pray that we would be a church that would love our children, that we would set a good example for these parents, and that we would support and we would love them, that we would support and love these children in any way that we can as a church. Father, we thank you that you love us, and we thank you for children. In Jesus Christ I pray, amen. You may be seated.
offertory hymn is God Give Us Christian Homes, hymn 653. Let's stand together and we'll sing all four verses, and our ushers will come at the end.
God give us Christian homes, homes where the Bible is loved and taught, homes where the Master's will is sought, homes crowned with beauty your love has wrought. God give us Christian homes, God give us Christian.
Pray with me. Father God, we love you and we thank you for the opportunity to come to your house to worship today. And Father, as we take these tithes and offerings, we pray that you bless them. Bless them that we're able to grow the kingdom throughout you fall and throughout the world. In your holy name I pray. Amen.
Thank you. You don't have to wash your hands.
I have so much time to myself. Hey, walk away when I'm talking to you. My kids really respect my privacy. When this timer goes off, please turn it off and do not tell me. Thanks. Here, can you use up all my battery? Don't call me when you get there. I don't want to know where you are.
It is just too quiet in this car.
Okay, we're about to leave for church, so if you're gonna make a huge mess, you better do it now.
I don't know. Your dad usually does everything around here. All of these people are such good drivers.
Eating dinner is completely optional. Hanging up your towel is completely optional. Flushing the toilet is completely optional. Okay, this time, can you smile more like a crazed lunatic? Hey, you want to dig through the fridge for the fifth time today? I'd definitely rather be here than at the beach. I am loving the look of these chips on the floor. I am loving the smell of your feet in my face. I am loving this back pain. Get a massage, ew, no thanks. Take anything you want from my closet and don't worry about putting it back. Don't look at the camera, look over there. If your sister takes your toy, just give her a good smack on the head. Hey, come drink that grape juice in here on the carpet. It's dinner time, everybody come get a snack. Hey, did you know you can wear the same pair of underwear all week long?
The life of a mother. If you have your Bibles, please take them and turn with me to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 66, and we're going to be looking at verse 13, and we're going to be using that as a springboard into some other scripture for our time together this morning in just a minute. I was reading a story this week about a mother who was putting her son to bed, who was it was the eve of his fifth birthday, and she was trying to communicate to him the idea that this was the last night of his fourth year. Do you understand that, Kevin? Kevin did and was ready to communicate with his hands. For a full year, he had shown people four fingers for his 4 years, and now he was ready to add that thumb. And seeing his four fingers, his mother nodded and said, "When you go to sleep tonight, you will still be 4 years old. But how old will you be tomorrow morning when you wake up?" And Kevin nodded enthusiastically, and while adding that thumb to his finger, he said, "When I wake up tomorrow, Mom, I'll be a handful." For all the ladies who have to deal with all the handfuls, we celebrate you today. And so I would like to ask you, if you're a mother, if you would now just stand for us, please. Proverbs 31, when it describes a superwoman, a godly woman, he wraps it up by saying, "Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her her reward she has earned, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate." Moms, ladies, we want to thank you for all that you do, for this church, for your families, and for our community. And now, sons, daughters, men, church, can we just take a minute and can we praise these special women in our lives? You may be seated. Indeed, life is a handful. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter how young you are. It doesn't matter your family dynamics. There's a lot to deal with, and there's a lot to manage in the life that we live. And in our passage of Scripture this morning, Isaiah, in a prophecy some 700 years before Jesus was born, gives us a beautiful picture of how we can find comfort in Him, how we can come and deal with all the handfuls of our life. So let's look at it together, Isaiah 66:13. It says, as a mother comforts her child, so will I comfort you, and you will be comforted over Jerusalem. As a mother comforts her child, so will I comfort you. In this verse, God gives us a picture of a mother comforting her child. In my mind, when I read this, I think about me being a small boy, running down the driveway, tripping, falling, and skinning my knee, and my mom comforting me. When I read this verse, I think about being a teenager, and my heart being broken for that first time, and my mom comforting me. When I read this verse, I think about being an adult, receiving a phone call, or going to the mailbox and opening it up, and opening a card from my mom, just saying I love you, praying for you, proud of you, and my mom comforting me. Moms, grandmothers, sisters, aunts, ladies, I want to thank you for the many ways that you bring comfort to so many people. I want to thank you for the way that you bring comfort by the way of protection. One of the pictures that Jesus uses to describe himself of his own protection and compassion is that of a hen and her chickens. In Matthew 23:37-39, we find Jesus expressing great sorrow over Jerusalem. And in part he says, how often have I longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. As a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. Can we show this picture? Let's see if we can pop it up there. No picture? Okay, sorry. There's supposed to be a picture of a mosaic of a mother hen protecting her chicks. And there's a mosaic that's in one of the Church of the Mount of Olives remembering this verse. Now, this image of a mother taking care of her babies gets our attention. Now, if you were driving down the road this afternoon and you looked out your window and you saw a hen covering her chicks with her outstretched wings, you would stop and you would marvel at how this hen takes care of her chicks. It's a picture of a weak being protected by the strong. And the image of a mother taking care of her babies gets people's attention. The kindness, the compassion, this protection is powerful. Can I just tell you that I saw an example of this firsthand this week on Wednesday night as I sat in the waiting room of our ER late one night with a group of moms. The insights, the compassion, the strength, the boldness, the concern, the love, the determination of these godly women to do whatever had to be done to take care of the little ones that were weak at that moment. It was powerful. It was as each of them began to stretch out their wings and cover the whole ER with their protective wings. It was special. It was powerful. An example of this protection in the Bible can be found in Exodus 2. Remember the mother of Moses? She could not hide her son from danger any longer, so she got a basket. And she fixed it just right and put her son and placed it in it and put it in the reeds along the bank of the Nile River. And then asked his big sister to go watch to see what happened to him. Crazy. Why would she do this? What was she doing? But she did this because she was willing to do whatever was necessary to take care, to protect her boy. Even if it meant doing something difficult, strange, or doing something different. You see, I don't read in this story of Moses that there was something that all the mamas were doing. This was not some social trend where the Nile River was full of baby boys floating down in the reeds. No, but this is a picture of a mom doing whatever she had to do to protect her boy, even if it was difficult, even if it was different. Now, here's the application this morning. In the world we live in today, the world that we're trying to raise our children in, There will be times that we will need to be different. There will be times that we need to do some difficult things to protect and raise our children to be who God wants them to be. You see, we may just need to be willing to have that Friday night, Saturday night conversation. No, you're not going there, and you're not going to do that. We may have that tough conversation. Daughters, girls, we are not going to wear that. We may need to have that conversation about putting boundaries on what we allow to enter our children's ears and eyes and minds and hearts. We may need to have that conversation. I'm sorry, but Sunday morning, we're going to get up and we're going to church. Now, we have to be careful not to overprotect our kids. We cannot wrap them up in bubble wrap. We can't lock them in their rooms. We can't remove them from the world, but we can prepare them. We can love them, we can train them, and teach them, and we can protect them while they're in this world. Moms, ladies, thank you so much for protecting us. Because in doing this, you give us a picture of how God loves and protects us. Thank you, moms, for presenting us to Jesus so that we can experience true comfort in Him. We live in a society today that puts so much pressure on our kids. The TVs, movies, social media, friends, and our culture in general send so many different and false messages to our kids. So many pressures, so many voices. But the good news today is that parents and research continues to show that over and over and over again, the number one influence in a child's life is you, is their parents. That's hard to believe, but research suggests that children still listen to their parents more than any other presence in their lives. And as parents, we have the responsibility to teach and set the standards for what is important to our children. Proverbs 22:6 reminds us, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Ephesians 6:4 says, bring them up in discipline and instruction of the Lord. Deuteronomy 4:7 reminds us, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. This commandment that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you wake up. Maybe you remember the Old Testament story of Hannah. She longed, desired to have children she couldn't have. She experienced that pain. But eventually God honored her cry and she became a mother of a boy named Samuel. And her number one desire was to present, to dedicate, to introduce, to teach him the ways of the Lord. Because if you read in 1 Samuel 1:22, when she said to her husband, after this boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always. I will present him to the Lord. Moms, thank you for offering your children up to the Lord. Thank you for presenting your child to God. For if we do not do it by design, by default, we will be offering them up to something else. As parents, we teach our children what's important. If your child comes to you and says that he and she is tired and maybe not feeling good, and you make them go to school anyway, you're teaching, you're telling them that school is very important. Likewise, when your child wakes up on Sunday morning and says he or she is tired or doesn't feel good, and we allow them to stay at home, we're teaching them that church is not that important. And the truth is, too many times we are teaching our children by default that their spiritual growth, their spiritual walk, is not that important. Parents, we set the standard for what is important to our children. Let me encourage you to get and to keep your students involved in a church. If it hasn't happened already, sometimes your student will come to you and say, oh, I don't want to go to church. None of my friends are going there. I got something else to do. And a lot of times, This will happen around the time that they get their driver's license. That is the time for you to be firm and encouraging. Continue to bring them to church with you and continue to share with them the importance of worship and Bible study. Now, over the years in doing student ministry, I've heard many, many excuses, some pretty good and some not too good, for not coming to church. And students are allowed to become a little less active. And not too long after that, they kind of disappear. They drop out. And all of a sudden, I start hearing that they're doing things, they're involved in things, they're facing things that they shouldn't be doing. And not too long after that, I'll get a call from the parents. What did we do wrong? I need your help to get my child back into church. I know our kids are busy. Busy with pressures of school, job, sports, friends, all important. But church needs and has to be a priority in their lives. And as parents, we teach our children what is important. Because our children, they're watching and they're listening to us. Maybe you've heard a story about a wife who invited a bunch of people over for dinner. And at the table, she turned to her little six-year-old girl and asked her if she would say the blessing. Well, this terrified this little girl and said, I just don't know what to say, Mama. And the mom said, just say what you have heard me always say. And the daughter bowed her head and prayed, Lord, why on earth did I invite all these people over to dinner tonight? You see, they're listening. What are we teaching them? What are we telling them? And in the story of 1 Samuel, if you keep reading it, you'll find out what happens because Hannah presented him to the Lord. The result was that Samuel grew up in the presence of the Lord. And over the years, I have not seen many children or youth or adults who just grew in the presence of the Lord by accident. See, how can we have students who grow in the presence of the Lord? How can we have a dynamic children's ministry? How can we have a dynamic youth ministry if only a few moms, parents, come with their children? 1 Samuel 2:26 tells us the boy Samuel continued to grow in stature and in favor with the Lord and with men. And if you keep reading on to 1 Samuel 3:20, it says that all of Israel from Dan to Beersheba recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord. You see what happened here? Samuel, because he was presented in the church and grew in the Lord, he became successful. The Bible actually says he kind of came famous. Everybody knew who he was. And just maybe you will have a child who will grow up and become famous too. The question is, what would they be famous for? Maybe your child is already famous at school today. What are they famous for? What are you presenting your child to? For Samuel, it spread far and wide that Samuel was attested, someone who was going to follow the Lord. And finally, moms, ladies, thank you for taking care of our needs. Staying with the story of Samuel, listen to what 1 Samuel 2:19 says. Each year, his mother made him a little robe and took it to him. I love that. Each year, his mother made a little robe and took it to him. I love this picture. Now, for many of us this morning, the hobby or the ability to sew or knit may be a little foreign idea to us. Today, the truth is, it's a lot easier to just run down to the store or pull up something online, order it, and have it at your door in a couple of days. But I remember growing up, seeing my mom, my grandmother, my aunts sitting at a sewing machine, sewing, fixing, hemming, patching holes in my jeans, creating, making something for me or my sister or for someone else. They would work hours, weeks, months. These ladies in my life would work hard, spending lots of time, energy, knitting and sewing, making sure everything was just right, that it was perfect. They were creating something for someone special. It was a picture of provision. This morning I have something that my grandmother made me when I was a little boy. And it's a little sleeping bag. There's nothing a whole real hard about it, whatever, but it's some cloth. It has a little pillow with horses built in it that you sewn in there so you don't have to worry about where it goes. And on the outside, there's a stocking and some fabric that's just kind of sewn on there. And I remember growing up and building tents in my rooms, forts, and getting under the tent, sleeping with this. And I remember sometimes laying in front of the TV, watching TV, falling asleep. I remember packing up and taking it to my grandparents and laying it down next to my grandparents' bed and going to sleep at night. A little bit later, my girls sometimes use this to lay on, to sleep on. And to me, this is something a whole lot more important than just something to lay on and to sleep on. To you, it may not be a big deal, but to me, it's something special. It's something important. But you see, that represents to me love and time and care, warmth and comfort, lots of thoughts, lots of prayers, insights, wisdom, the desire for me to be taken care of and secure. To me, that's the provision of a godly woman. And I believe this is what we see. This is the picture we see in 1 Samuel 2:19. The Bible tells us that every year Hannah would make a robe just for Samuel and take it to him. It's a picture of a mom taking care of her son's need. Every year, Hannah would work hard to make a robe that was just right for her son. This would have been an outer coat to wear over other coats. And this probably was one that looked a lot like what the priest wore. This robe was from her own hands, her own spinning and weaving. And all this Hannah did to take care of her boy. Because of her great love for him, she knew what he needed and took care of him. So ladies, this morning, we thank you for the many ways that you take care of us. Because in doing this, you give us a picture of how God wants to take care of us. Now dads, son, guys, let's have a quick little talk for a second. I read this week that the average man is 38 around the chest, 32 around the waist, 95 around the golf course, and a general nuisance around the house. Guys, how do we comfort our wives, our moms? Are we protecting them from overbusyness, from discouragement, from frustration, feeling like the whole world is coming right down on her? Husbands, do we do what Ephesians 5 instructs us to do, to love your wives just as Christ loves the church and gave himself up for her? Sons, are we obeying our moms? Guys, do we provide for our wives emotionally? Do we talk to her? Do we listen? Do we help her? Just maybe this morning, maybe every morning, you need to look at your wife before you walk out the door, look her in the eyes, and maybe say, or if you're brave, maybe sing the words to that old song, "Lean on me when you're not strong. I'll give you help. I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on." Will you pray with me? Father, we are so thankful for times like this that we can celebrate our mothers and the influence they have had on our lives. Father, this morning I'm thankful for my mother, for the way she protected me, the way she raised me, the way she taught me, and the way that she took care of me. I'm thankful for many other ladies growing up who had an influence on me and my life at different times that have helped me be who I am today. Whether it was family members or teachers, Sunday school teachers, friends, neighbors. Father, this morning I'm so thankful for my wife. Thank you for bringing her into my life, for the way she loves me. She helps me. She stands by me. And that she takes care of me. Father, as a husband and a man, I know I don't do a very good job of telling her, showing her that. Father, I'm thankful for all the ladies in our church, whether they're a mom, an expecting mom, or not able to be a mom. I'm thankful for the way that you use them to point others to you. God, I pray that each lady here today would feel and understand just how special, how beautiful, how important, and how valuable they are to their families, this church, and most importantly, to you. Because the truth is this morning that this verse that we looked at this morning of a mom comforting her children is a picture of what you want to do for us. Your desire is to comfort your children. So, God, I pray that you be with those that are here today that may be struggling. Maybe those of us who have lost their moms. Maybe those who have maybe lost a child. Those who long to have a child but can't. Maybe those who are separated from or struggling in their relationships with the child. Maybe there's moms in our church that have children that are sick and struggling health-wise today. God, you know our hearts. You know our desires. And I pray that you would make your presence known to us today. Father, thank you for being a God who comforts your children. In Jesus Christ I pray, amen. As we close our time together today, I'd like for us just to stand, and maybe this will be our prayer that whether you're a mom or a dad or a child, husband, wife, friend, and maybe we'd just be willing to live our life and all that we do, that it would glorify God. Would you stand and sing with us? Again, thank you for being here today, and I hope that you've had a good time with us, you felt God's presence, and I pray that you will have a good afternoon. Billy McClendon, will you end us with a word of prayer this morning?
The footprints that we leave lead
lead them to believe, and the lies we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful.